Joining me now is Margaret Spellings, former United States Secretary of Education. Secretary Spellings, it's such a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you so much for your time. This whole debate seems to have developed into mayhem with so many different opinions on what schools reopening should look like, where in the state these schools should open. Can you break down for us what the main concerns are for physically returning back to the classroom this year?
Well, it's because every single situation is so different. Individual health of the students, the workforce, our teachers and educators, the health capacity, the disease prevalence, on and on and on. And I think the lawsuit that you just mentioned is yet another example of the confusion that ensues around these issues. And so, what I'm seeing is people are not really looking to Washington for guidance. They're looking to their state officials, their local officials, especially those superintendents and their county judges and health officials, to really find the answers. Parents need clarity. They need options. They understand the complexity of the issues before them. And, we've got to get this straightened out very soon so that families can plan, people can work, and educators can stay healthy and productively engaging students.
Secretary, I think it's safe to say it was a bumpy rollout this spring as many parents were staying home during quarantine and, I don't want to say, teaching their kids at home, doing remote learning. Sure. Has there been an effort to make remote learning more successful as we enter the new school year?
No question there has. And educators really were caught off guard, as many of us were with this pandemic, sadly. But they have scrambled this summer. There's been a lot of state leadership. I've seen a lot of investments from the CARES Act that have been put toward the enhanced broadband and enhanced devices so our students can access those online courses. There's consortia of content groups like National Geographic and all manner of product that can be pushed out to our students. So yes, they've dramatically ramped up, and we'll see those improvements in the fall in our hybrid and online options.
Secretary, can we talk about what kind of effect remote learning has on students and on their education? Because we're hearing so much about how it could affect children socially by not being in the classroom.
Sure, these are not optimal options for families or for students. But one issue that I think is getting undersold or short shrift in this is that our students need to learn, they need to be productively and engaged in their creating their futures. They need to have connections with adults and other leaders. And so, this is the best we're going to be able to do in the near term, either hybrid options or online, and in some cases, face-to-face, in-person learning, and every variation on the theme due to community variances, workforce, and student variances.
Let's talk about the possibility of face-to-face learning. We know space is limited. There will be social distancing. How do you explain something like that to elementary school students, kindergartners, first graders? And how much learning can happen if teachers are spending so much time trying to keep these kids to social distance or maybe wear a mask?
Like anything new, it'll take some adjusting. But one thing we know about human beings is that they can adjust. And so we're seeing, people wear masks pretty fulsome ways now. They get it. And our kids will comply and adapt as well. I've seen a lot of creativity with school leaders in terms of safety and petitioning and, not meeting in the cafeteria, circles on the floor. Little kids want to be rule followers. They want to follow structure. They want to and do listen to their adult teachers. And so, is it optimal? No, but doing nothing, staying at home, just retreating is not optimal either. Our kids need to be learning. It'll be different, but we'll get through it. It's not a long-term situation in the giant scheme of things, and it's the best we can do.
All great points. Secretary Spellings, I know I don't have to tell you this. Many schools are facing huge budget cuts as states grapple with drastically lower tax revenues, of course, because of the pandemic. Will they physically be able to implement these policies that they need to reopen safely for some schools, some states, as early as 3 or 4 weeks?
Well, that's why we need the CARES Act funding to be deployed in this way and additional federal funds. I mean, states do not have the opportunity to print money like the federal government can. And I think we all recognize that there will be no learning without safe, protective environments for our teachers and educators and for our students. And so I know in my own home state of Texas, there have been funds reserved to provide cleaning supplies and protective equipment. That's good and fine. But we will need more resources given the economic conditions that are quite dire around the country. But listen, we cannot lose this generation of students, and this is our future. It sounds hokey to say, but we've got to find the resources to make sure that our country can recover from this and we can have a sound footing for all of them.
I have to ask you, Secretary Spellings, how do you think the current administration is dealing with the pandemic and when it comes to reopening our schools in the fall?
You know, I think sadly, you know, people are not looking to Washington for answers. They're looking to their local officials, their superintendents, their teachers, their health officials, and their governors to provide the answers. And so while we certainly hope they'll get their act together around resources in terms of just the actual practicalities of going back to school are not going to be found in DC.
I have to ask, wouldn't that make the whole process more chaotic?
Well, you know, we need local solutions because every community is different. The workforce is different. The health infrastructure is different. The prevalence of disease is different. It's not really a place for a one-size-fits-all mandate of going back to school 5 days or whatever. I mean, these are truly local decisions. And by the way, let's not forget the people who pay the bills for our schools are state and local taxpayers. And so, you know, he who has the gold makes the rules.
What would it mean if, let's say, these threats from the White House somehow come to fruition and funding is pulled from certain schools?
You know, the Congress has appropriated funds for Title IX, for Title I, for IDEA, for all the various federal programs, and they have been deployed in those ways as specified by the Congress and signed by the president. And so prospectively, they could consider requirements around new federal funds, but frankly, they don't have the authority to withhold those funds that have already been appropriated for particular purposes. I also believe that this just adds, you know, additional confusion to an already very complex situation. And so, you know, our school people on the front lines are just trying to get it done, get families and students back in schools, keep their workforce safe, and educate this next generation.
So true. Fantastic insight. Margaret Spellings, former United States Secretary of Education. Secretary Spellings, such a pleasure to have you on. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Gladly.